Hello, this is the Provoked Prawn, and this is the NZXT N7 Z590 motherboard. In this video, I'm going to be unboxing and installing this motherboard and talking to you about the various highlights of it and the features and the things of interest. There are a number of different things that make it worth talking about. This is an affordable motherboard with a number of interesting highlights. This is obviously an 11th gen motherboard that's able to accept both Intel's 10th gen and 11th gen CPUs with some differences. If you use an 11th gen CPU, for example, you get PCIe Gen 4 in the NVMe port and in the PCIe top slot as well. So it opens up more capabilities there. And for this build, I'm using Intel's i7-11700K along with a number of other things that you've seen. I'm building it in a DeepCool CK560 mid-tower case along with the DeepCool AK620 CPU tower cooler. And I want to talk to you about the various different things of interest. Now this is, as I said, an affordable motherboard and one that comes packaged as such. I was really surprised, for example, when I opened it up and started taking things out of the box, just how little there is included. I also do, however, fully approve of the packaging because it's very much cardboard and semi-minimal plastic, so it's quite good for the environment, but I was shocked by how little you get as standard included in here. It's basically two little drawers on the underside that you pull out, and then you've got access to the various different things that you'll need. Those include mostly data cables for your SATA connections to your hard disk drives or SSDs, which are very limited, by the way, and I'll talk about that in a bit more depth in a minute. And you also have some aerials for the Wi-Fi, which is also a quirk, which I'll talk about a bit later on. And then two M2 screws for connecting up M2 NVMe SSDs. So you'll see that we have data cables included in the box, and I'll show you where those plug in later on. But there are only four SATA connections on this motherboard. So fairly limited for storage if you're looking at setting it up with hard disk drives or SSDs. And if you have a number of them, then you are going to come unstuck. This is, however, an affordable board, so should expect some takeaways from that. And you do have these antennas for Wi-Fi connectivity. So this gives you the option to basically screw those into the rear of the motherboard and then improve the Wi-Fi signal, which is definitely a benefit. However, I will note that you will need an Ethernet connection for setting this thing up, because what I found is the drivers don't work immediately, so you do need to download them from the NZXT website in order to get the drivers working properly and then have Wi-Fi access. So it's worth keeping that in mind. Now, as I said, this is a 11th gen motherboard, which means it's LGA 1200 socket, and it also has limited support for DDR4 RAM up to 4600 MHz overclocked RAM when you're using an 11th gen CPU, or 4400 MHz overclocked with a 10th gen CPU. But as standard, the frequencies are basically up to a maximum of 3200 in various different ranges. I'll leave all the specs in the description, but there are a few things of interesting highlight when I got out of the box, and immediately, as you'll see, it has quite a striking protective face over the top of it, and that actually has some problems that I'll show you later on. There's also some curiosities in here. You'll notice, for example, in the top left, we have an 8-pin CPU power connector and then a 4-pin next to that. The 8-pin is required, the 4-pin is optional. However, I do like to install both of those so you have the maximum power draw, but it is a fiddle, as I'll show later on. On the right-hand side, you'll notice that you have two NZXT RGB connectors. Obviously, if you're using an RGB case from NZXT or with fans and things, you have the option to connect there. At the bottom, you'll also notice there are both 12-volt and 5-volt RGB connectors. And in the bottom right, there's also the USB connection for the front panel. Unusual placement at the bottom there. And there are two USB connections worth bearing in mind. I was also surprised to see three USB internal headers that you can see here. So that gives you the option, obviously, to plug in things like fan controllers. Now, I've seen actually higher-end motherboards with only two ports on here, so it's really cool to see three. on such an affordable board have the ability to plug in multiple different devices, whether that's a CPU cooler, all-in-one cooler, for example, fan controller, RGB controllers, gives you a variety of options for plugging in multiple things without even needing to worry about USB splitters, which is pretty neat. So that's worth keeping in mind. And a nice little highlight. Alongside those, you'll see the system fan headers for internal fans, for your case fans as well. So there's a multitude of different connections there along the bottom, and also extra fan connections at the top too. So there's lots of different connections. I really like the placement of the USB connections as well, so we'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. But as I said, also you have the 12 volt or 5 volt RGB headers, as well as the NZXT RGB headers at the top of the motherboard as well. Now, it is worth noting that this is a Gen 4 PCIe motherboard, but you will want to use the top slot on the top PCIe X16 slot. That will give you the maximum speed for your graphics card. So if you're using a GPU in this build, which you naturally will be, then you need to make sure that you're using the top slot there. That will give you the PCIe X16 X16 mode, so that's maximum speed there. If you use the secondary slot, you're only going to get that at X4, so make sure you use your GPU in the top there. And here you can see me plugging in those antennas. Obviously, I'm just demonstrating that now, but you'd really wait until it was fully installed in the case. Now, buried underneath this protective shield on the outside is two NVMe SSD ports as well, so you have the option to add in two NVMe SSDs. And for the purpose of this build, I'm going to be using one Gen 4 and one Gen 3. And that's actually logical because the top slot, as I'll talk about in a moment, is faster than the bottom one. So just bear that in mind. Along the top of the motherboard, you have AIO pump connections, more system fan headers, and the RGB connections. And you'll also notice that on the rear for the IO, we have a mass of different rear IO connections as well. So lots of different connections here. Really pleasing to see all of this on an affordable motherboard. So you've got one USB 3.2 Gen 2x2 Type C port, three Type A Gen 2 USB ports, and four Gen 1 ports, as well as a USB 2.0. And then you have HDMI, as well as the other connections for audio and optical connections, for example. You'll notice on the other side of the motherboard, there are just four SATA connections. As I said, that is alongside the USB front panel connection as well. So again, two different positions for the USB front panel. So if you have those dual connections, you need both. If you have a case that has multiple different front panel connections, then you do have the option of plugging that in there. You'll also notice next to the 24-pin power supply cable is the USB-C connection as well. So lots of different connectivity there. Now, this is LGA 1200 socket, which means that it will support both 10th gen and 11th gen Intel CPUs. As I said already, I'm using the 11th gen 11700K, so it's an i7 CPU installed in here, alongside a CPU tower cooler, because I wanted to demonstrate the process for this. I'm going to leave a link in the description to the videos on both the case and the cooler if you're curious about that and want to find out more about the setup and the features and highlights of those things. I just wanted to demonstrate a close look up at the installation for this and the process for setting it up. Basically, very simple, removing that top plate, installing the CPU with a gold pin in the bottom corner, and then gently placing it down. Standard setup, standard motherboard, and nice and easy too. The benefit of this motherboard I found is it actually ran nice and cool with the CPU in place too, and the setup that I had ended up working really well. So I recommend checking that out. It definitely is a nice setup for that. And there's no extra problems with any of the hardware in terms of the large heat sinks and other things seated around it, with the exception of one thing, which I will show a little bit later on. I am using Kingston Fury Beast RAM for this build, and this is DDR4. I'm only using two sticks, so we're going to have 32 gigabytes of RAM, and you'll notice that it is RGB RAM as well. This is also not low profile RAM, and yeah, it does sit nicely under the tower cooler. Now, there is logic to this. You do need to install your RAM in the right way if you're not aware already. So if you've not seen this in the manual, you do need to make sure that you install, if you're only using two sticks, in the fourth and second slot in that order. So obviously you need two sticks in this order to make sure that they're working properly. I've done a video separately on RAM and things you should check and the things you need to know before purchasing RAM and upgrading your RAM. If you want to add more in future, what to do there. So I'll leave a link to that video in the description. I'm using two NVMe SSDs for this. I was recently asked what I would recommend in terms of the setup for hard drives and whether you should install Windows on a drive or a hard disk drive. I actually personally prefer to use two SSDs if possible, so one for Windows and your software and the other one for games. And so that's basically what we'll be doing in this one. Now, the top slot on this motherboard is for PCIe Gen 4 X4, so you'll get the maximum speed out of this, assuming that you're using an 11th gen CPU. And that's an important point of note, because a 10th gen CPU will fit in here, but if you use that, you'll only be able to use Gen 3 PCIe lanes, so you won't be able to use maximum speed with a Gen 4 NVMe, and you will get much faster speeds with a Gen 4. So this is WD Black SN850 that was purchased for this build. It's a 1 terabyte drive, and because that's the fastest drive I've got out of these two, because I'm going to be using a Samsung Evo 970 in the bottom slot, which is Gen 3. I'm going to make sure I install it in the top. Installing Windows on this, and then anything else that you want to run quickly. So you might have a select number of games, for example, that you're really keen on. Once you've set it into place, you obviously use the tiny little screw that's included in the motherboard. It comes in a little bag, and then just basically screw it back down. And then you've got to put these little plates back on. They're held in place with a clip, but there's no sort of thermal pad over the top, which I thought was unusual. Most motherboards that you find when you remove those usually have some sort of thermal cooling pad, but these are plastic covers and there's no cooling pad there, which is a bit unusual. 970 Evo is going in the bottom, same process, plug and play. That's the good thing about these drives. I've done videos separately on how to install these drives if you're curious. They're really simple though, you don't need any extra cables, and they're much more preferable to SSD or hard disk drives, because it's basically plug and play for the most part, and you get much faster speeds out of them. They are a bit more expensive, but they're worth paying out for. And on this motherboard, they're basically hidden away by those plates when you should put those back into place. One of the things that I did find about these though is they're a little bit fiddly to get into place, and as you will see, I made a bit of a hash of putting the bottom one back on. There are clips on either side of it, and it is a little bit fiddly to do, and I thought I got it right, but then it was hanging off. So if you see that in a second, I do apologize, but I did sort it out by the end of the build, so it does end up looking okay. So now we have that set up, we've got the RAM set up, we've got the CPU in place, the NVMe SSDs, and now I'm just installing the back plate for this cooler. I'm not going to go through the entire process of this because I've done this already in the separate video on the cooler itself if curious, but you can see there are four holes and you need an LGA 1200 socket bracket and standoff screws for this, so you gotta make sure you're installing your cooler. I usually recommend installing it beforehand. Now I'm using a CPU tower cooler. I also like to use liquid coolers, and you do have the option to use either. As I said, there's an AIO pump header at the top and the right hand side, there's also a CPU fan header on top left, and I'm running two fans off of this cooler into that CPU fan header for this setup, and that makes for a really straightforward installation process. This DeepCool cooler is also really straightforward for the setup here as well. So a couple of shots of the steps of it. It comes with a wire splitter cable, and then you just plug it into that CPU fan header and then give the motherboard control over this. It's worth noting this motherboard does work with NZXT's CAM software, which gives you control over fan speed and RGB lighting directly within it. So if you have RGB controls in here, if you're plugging RGB strips in, for example, or RGB fan headers, then you can also make the most of controlling the lighting in there. So there's lots of different capabilities from that too. So this is the basic setup, and really straightforward. And as you can see, it's coming together quite nicely now. And there are definitely some highlights to it. I really like the overall look and feel of this motherboard. Considering the price, it has some nice features. It's a shame that not both M2 slots are Gen 4 X4, which would have been beneficial, but otherwise for the most part pretty effective for the money. And I really like the overall look of the protective plating over the front. However, that does lead to some issues. There are no issues with any of the VRMs in terms of mounting a cooler like this though, which is certainly one of the niceties. I have seen issues with Noctua coolers, with certain motherboards having raised housing that just prevents you from easily being able to install something like this. That's not an issue here at all. And as you can see, that also sits nicely with the RGB RAM, which isn't exactly low profile. It does end up looking the business from multiple angles. It's got a nice contrast of the black and white. Now, one of the things I did want to demonstrate, though, and this is probably the biggest problem I had with this motherboard, is actually installation. There are multiple points, obviously, where you would sit the motherboard down. This is an ATX motherboard, and this case is able to hold both ATX, EATX, and other sizes too. The standard standoffs are fine with it, but what I found is actually the motherboard screws are really difficult to get in. The top ones are straightforward because there's none of the protective housing around the top of the motherboard, but all the other points, so you can see the four points that are really obvious here, for example, in the four corners below the CPU tower on the right and left hand side, I found those really difficult to get in. The motherboard screws that are included with the case have quite a wide top to them, and you basically had to force them through the hole of the protective plating in order to get them into the screw holes. So the word of warning when you go to do this is pretty terrifying, because it's very difficult to get those screws through there and then to seat them down and screw them in properly. This is perhaps the biggest complaint I had about this motherboard, and generally otherwise I think it's a really good motherboard, because you have a number of really nice features in it, good logic and thought out, and awesome things that you wouldn't see elsewhere. One of the other ones that I have is the fiddly nature of the motherboard cabling and the setup for the power connections. So earlier on I showed you that it has one 8-pin power supply unit cable and then one 4-pin, so you can split your one of your eight pins into a 4-pin and then plug it in. Found this remarkably difficult to do in the case. Just this is part of the installation hassle of your case and motherboard setup, but it is going to vary from case to case. And also, if I hadn't installed the tower cooler, it wouldn't have been quite as fiddly, but it is fairly unusual to see one with a 4-pin. However, that 4-pin is optional. You do require the 24-pin power supply cable and the 8-pin in the top left as a minimum, and the other one is optional, but it is worth doing. Make sure you have full power, especially if you're planning on doing any overclocking or anything like that. So just a quick look at the right hand side for the 24 pin power cable that I was talking about. Got to make sure this one's plugged in. I'm doing it outside the box just to give you a demo of that, but just remember below that as well is the USB-C front panel connection, and here is the USB-A one, which is the fat one I was talking about. Just want to show you the position of that again. So that's off to the right hand side just below the 24 pin, and then again you have one at the bottom as well. So if you have two lots of USB-A front panel connections, you've got a big case with loads of different connections, and you can plug those in down the bottom. So there you have it, that is the end result of this case. Now don't forget, when you go about installing Windows, I would highly recommend going and downloading the drivers from the NZXT website, and also use Intel's updating tool. I'll link to both those in the description, but you will need to use an Ethernet connection, sadly, to do this, or to get the drivers downloaded on a different machine and then install them on here before you can use the wireless. This does have wireless 6E though, so it is worth using the Wi-Fi 6E, and obviously those antennas will give you the boost in connectivity. This has been the Rogue Prawn. Be sure to check out the full build videos linked in the description. Let me know if you've got any comments. Stop by my Discord and say hello, and a big shout out to my YouTube members who support the channel. Thanks very much for watching. This has been the Provoked Prawn. Hope you found this video useful, interesting, hilarious, or otherwise. Take a look at these other videos that I think you might find interesting as well. And have a look at the description for links and other information you might find useful. Click that join button to see the benefits of being a member of my YouTube channel. And most importantly, have a great life.